فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Brothers and sisters, in this khutbah بإذن الله الكريم, I want to talk about a very important topic. And it becomes even more important due to the time that we're in. Inshallah, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, tomorrow will be the day of Eid. There's a responsibility in particular that is on our shoulders. And it's a responsibility that many of us have forsaken. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us the power and the strength in order to fulfill this responsibility. Ikhwani, this responsibility is brotherhood. Loving one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, today's khutbah, I want to talk about this topic. Inshallah, I plan to talk about this topic in this khutbah today. 3 points. The first, inshallah, is ma'na al-ukhuwa wa haqiqatuha. What is brotherhood or sisterhood? And what is the reality of it? The second, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, is haqqul akh ala akhi. The rights a brother has on another brother and a sister has on another sister. The third, inshallah, which is the last, which is wasail, means ta'miqi al-ukhuwa, means to strengthen the bond of brotherhood. I start with the first one, which is what is brotherhood and what does it mean? Ikhwani, first we know that brotherhood is two types. Ukhuwatun nasab, brotherhood by means of lineage, brother by blood. And the second one is ukhuwatul aqidatu wa deen, brotherhood by means of religion, faith is what bonds you with this person. My khutbah, inshallah, I want to focus on ukhuwatul deen, brotherhood that comes by way of aqidah and belief. And that is the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran as He mentions the others. قال الله تعالى الله سبحانه وتعالى He said إنما المؤمنون إخوة. The believers are brothers to one another. But if a lot of us ponder and we look at the context in which Allah mentioned this ayah, we will be amazed. Because the ayah before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about اقتتال. He talks about the fighting that may occur from two groups of Muslims. And He also talks about one of the groups is an oppressor, a wrongdoer. Allah reminds us the ayah to come that we are brothers to one another. قَالَ تَعَالَى وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ قَتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِن بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. So Allah is talking about two armies, two Muslims that are fighting one another. When He tells us how to bring solution between them two, it's that one of the groups, another third group comes in and tries to bring peace between the two that are fighting. And if it doesn't listen, then the one that is not listening, they will wage war on that one. Allah reminded them even then, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. They are your brothers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He did that in another place in Surah Al-Baqarah. قَالَ تَعَالَى يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِصَاصُ فِي الْقَتْلَى الْحُرُّ بِالْحُرِّ وَالْعَبْدُ بِالْعَبْدِ وَالْأُنْثَى بِالْأُنْثَى فَمَنْ عُفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ شَيْءٍ. Allah mentions a person killed a family member of yours. You are now requesting for either the killing of this person because he killed a family member of yours, or you are requesting for some form of your rights. Allah says to us subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever forgives his brother, even that though he has killed a family member of yours, that brotherhood, that bond, it doesn't cut. So we are not the ones that determine who is our brother in Islam or who isn't. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala determined in the Quran, and we have to submit and listen to it. The Messenger Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who Allah said to us in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. For verily in the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a good example. Our Messenger for 13 years was establishing the Tawheed in Mecca. He was teaching them to worship Allah alone and not to associate Him with any partners. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he succeeded in this and he did it, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made sure that he embedded in the companions also the brotherhood that they need to come with. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He spoke about that in the Quran. قال الله تعالى, Allah said, وَإِذْ وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us the people of Medina, the Ansar, the two main tribes of Medina were the Aus and the Khazraj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us those who loved their brothers who came to them from Mecca. And when they came to them from Mecca, they found in their hearts love towards them. And they did not find any form of hate or enmity in their hearts towards them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went on to saying, وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they said, they give precedence to those who have come to them, even if it's something that they want. So even if they want that thing, that object, they will sacrifice it for their brothers that they had. And وَلِذَٰلِكَ, it's something that has been seen in the examples of the companions. رَوَى الشَّيْخَيْنِ الْإِمَامُ الْبُخَارِي and Muslim, both of them narrated in their authentic book, the hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an. When the messenger came to Medina, أخا بين المهاجرين والأنصار. The messenger made brotherhood between the muhajirin who had just come from Mecca, who left their children and their women and everything that they owned in Mecca, and he brought them to Medina. When they came to Medina, the messenger said, "You muhajir are the brother of the Ansari now," and the brotherhood bond came. قال تعالى واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون. Allah mentions that there was a time when the people hated one another. Some of the tribes in the Arabs, if you look at how they were and you read their biography prior to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming, they were fighting over petty stuffs. They were fighting over things that meant nothing. Sometimes, subhanAllah, they were fighting for so long, they even forgot why they were fighting for. So then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, and this bond of brotherhood is what he brought between them. And Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an, one of the two people that the Prophet, he brought bond between was a great companion from the 10 that was promised Jannah whilst he was alive, AbdulRahman ibn Awf radiallahu ta'ala an, and a man from the people of Ansar, Sa'd, Ibn al-Rabi'at al-Ansari, he bonded them two, and then said, "You two are brothers." When Sa'd was told that this is your brother from the Muhajirin, and this is the one that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has chosen for you, look what he said to him, brothers, Allahu Akbar. This is a sign of how the companions understood the reality and the meaning of brotherhood. This is something, wallahi, a lot of us, we lack. He said to him, "Inni aktharul ansari mala." The people of Ansar, I'm one of the most wealthiest of the people of Ansar. I have a lot of money. فَأَقْسِمُ مَالِي نِصْفَيْنِ. I'm going to divide my wealth into two. Divide it into two. وَلِي مْرَأَتَانِ, meaning I take half of my wealth. So whatever I have, I possess right now, I will divide it into two. Half of it is yours. وَلِي مْرَأَتَانِ, and I have two wives. What did he say to him? He didn't say, "I will choose the one that you're going to take," but rather he said, "Fanzur a'jabuhuma." Look at both my wives, whichever one that amazes you, she's yours. And I want you all to take this into consideration. The Arabs were very known not to let their wives be seen by any man, or rather, they were very strong and rigid on that matter. A man would bring his wife to the battle in the time of pre-Islamic era, and even when Islam came, they would bring their women to the back of the lines of the army. And it was an indication to show, "I will never run away in this battle, and I will not let anyone take my wife as a sebi, a spoil of war." So this was a sign of dignity for their women. But when Ansar radiallahu ta'ala anhum jami'an, they understood the reality and the meaning of ukhuwah, brotherhood and sisterhood, this is the way they dealt with one another. They took the Quran wholeheartedly. They didn't take what they want, and they didn't leave what they want. He said to him, "I have two wives. Whichever of those fascinates you and you like, take her. She is yours. فسميها, tell me, أطلقها, I will divorce her. فإنقضت عدتها, if she finishes her menstrual cycle, فتزوجها, marry her, she's yours." And that was how they understood. And that is the reality of ukhuwah. So the first part of my khutbah, inshallah, I've explained it. What does ukhuwah mean, and what is haqiqah, what is reality? This is what is brotherhood is, brothers. That we understand it in that way, and that we don't choose who we want to take as a brother and who we don't want to take as a brother. The second point, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, that I want to speak about, inshallah, is haqqul akhi ala akhi, the rights that a brother has on another brother, or a sister has on another sister. I've concluded bi-idhnillahi al-kareem with my very short understanding, only 9 points. And of course, there are more than that, inshallah. The first rights that they have on one another is min haqqil akhi ala akhihi an yuhibbahu lillah. The rights that a Muslim brother has on another Muslim brother, or a sister has on another sister, is that you should love them for the sake of Allah. So that's the first one. And not to mention, if this person holds the same Islamic principles as you, and they hold the same Islamic values, you have to love them for the sake of Allah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَوْثَقُ عُرَى الْإِيمَانِ الْحُبُّ فِي اللَّهِ وَالْبُغْضُ فِي اللَّهِ. The high branches of Iman is to love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake and to hate for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake. So when you hate somebody, you hate them for Allah's sake subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you love them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, in the hadith Abu Dawood narrated in his Sunan, Ibn Abi Shaybah narrated in his Musannaf, and Tabarani narrated in his Mu'jam al-Kabir. And Shaykh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani authenticated it in his Sahih al-Jami' and also his Silsila Hadith al-Sahihah, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من أحب لله وأبغض لله وأعطى لله ومنع لله فقد استكمل الإيمان. Anyone who loves for Allah's sake and anyone who hates for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake, and whoever gives for Allah's sake and whoever refuses for Allah's sake, for verily that person has completed his Iman. So the Iman is based for us to love for Allah's sake. We should love our Muslim brothers who have the same belief as us, who hold the same methodology as us, who hold the same aqeedah and the manhaj as us. Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, from the Immatul Nuqad and the Hufad al-Kibar, he used to say, إِن بَلَغَكَ عَنْ رَجُلٍ بِالْمَشْرِقِ أَوْ بِالْمَغْرِبِ. If you ever hear that there's a man in the East or the West, and that individual, أَنَّهُ صَاحِبَ السُنَّةِ, and he's a man or a woman who holds the creed of the Sunnah, they give value to the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and you hear that, فَبْعَثْ إِلَيْهِ بِالسَّلَامِ, send that person a greeting, wherever they are in the world. Don't forsake that person. وَادْعُوا اللَّهَ لَهُ, make dua for that person, that Allah makes them steadfast, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّ أَهْلَ السُنَّةِ فِي الْأُمَّةِ قَلِيلٌ, for verily the people of the Sunnah are little today. So the person shall love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers, Al-Imam Muslim, in his kitab Al-Birr wa Silah, rahimahullah, he narrated a hadith that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the day of judgment, أين المتحابون بجلالي, where are those who love one another in my honor, اليوم today, أظلهم, I will shade them, في ظلي, in my shade, يوم لا ظل إلا ظلي, the day there is no shade except my shade. So the people who love one another for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake and not for anything other than Allah's sake, they will gain a shade when there is no shade. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also narrated the hadith Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both collected in their authentic book. Min hadith Anas ibn Malik, the hadith has reached haddu tawatur. It has reached meaning multitude narration. Lafzan wa ma'nan, in terms of its wording and its meaning. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ, a person who has these three in him, فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ, that individual has found the sweetness of Iman. The first one is what? أَنْ يَكُونَ اللَّهِ, that Allah Azza wa Jal, وَرَسُولُهُ, and His Messenger, أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا سِوَاهُمَا, that they are more beloved to you than anything that has ever walked on this earth. Then the parents that gave birth to you, then the wife that you're married to and your children. You love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah more. The second one is, وَأَنْ يُحِبَّ الْمَرْأَ لَا يُحِبُّهُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, that you love an individual, a believer, and you only love them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is his rights. And the last one, which is, وَأَنْ يَكْرَهَ أَنْ يَعُودَ فِي الْكُفْرِ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُقْذَفَ فِي النَّارِ, that the person hates to go to Christianity and kufr and ilhad, the way he hates to be thrown into the hellfire. So the second one is what my mahallul istishad, the place I'm trying to extract the root or the dalil from, which is, أَنْ يُحِبَّ الْمَرْءَ لَا يُحِبُّهُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, that you do not love an individual, a believer, except you love them for the sake of Allah. And what increases this in amazement is the hadith Imam Muslim narrating in his Sahih, من حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه. He said, أَنَّ رَجُلًا زَارَ أَخًا لَهُ, a man went to visit a brother of his fi qaryatin ukhra, in another village or another town. Meaning he went to visit him in a place that he didn't live. So he traveled just to visit a brother of his. When he went and he made his way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel. فَأَرْسَدَ اللَّهُ لَهُ عَلَى مَدْرَجَتِهِ مَلَكًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent for him an angel from high above. Allahu Akbar. And then when the angel came down, فَلَمَّا أَتَى عَلَيْهِ قَالَ, the angel said to the man, أَيْنَ تُرِيدُ, where do you want to go? Where are you heading? He said, أُرِيدُ أَخَلِّي فِي هَذِهِ الْقَرْيَةِ. There's a brother I want who lives in this place that I'm heading towards. He said to him, هَلْ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تَرُبُّهَا. Is there a ni'mah that he has done for you? Is it masalih? Is it benefits that you're trying to get from him? Worldly pleasures? Something you're trying to gain from him? He replied by saying, لا, no. غير أني أحببته في الله عز وجل, except that I love him for the sake of Allah. This is the only reason why I've taken these steps. This is the only reason why I've traveled from where I was. The angel says to him, that was sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says to him, he says to him, اعلم نو بأن الله قد أحبك كما أحببته فيه. Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you as you have loved him. So loving your brother is a right that he has on you. الإمام الترمذي, إمام الترمذي, both ways you can say it. He narrated in his Sunan, and Imam Malik ibn Anas narrated in his Muwatta, بسند صحيح, with a chain of narration that is authentic, that a tabi'i who went by the name Aba Idris al-Khawlani, he said, دَخَلْتُ مَسْجِدَ دمشق. I entered the masjid of Dimashq. And when I entered, فَإِذَا فَتَنْ شَابٌ بَرَّاقٌ ثَنَايَا, I saw a young boy, beautiful, well-dressed. I saw him. وَإِذَا النَّاسُ مَعَهُ, and the people are around him. إِذَا اخْتَلَفُوا فِي شَيْءٍ, if they dispute one another in a matter, أَسْنَدُوا إِلَيْهِ, they bring the matter back to him. They bring it back to him. وَصَدَرُوا عَنْ قَوْلِهِ, and there his verdict, what he gives, becomes a solution to their matter. I mean, they take it from him. فَسَأَلْتُ عَنْهُ, I requested, who is this man that is everyone is coming to? It was then told to me, إِنَّهُ مُعَاذِ بْنُ جَبَلْ, this man that you see is Mu'adh ibn Jabal, fatan saghir, a young man. Abu Idris al-Khawlani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, amma rahimahullah, he said, فَلَمَّا كَانَ الْغَدُّ هَجَّرْتُ, when it was the next day, I went for salatu al-tahjir, meaning dhuhr. فَوَجَدْتُ قَدْ سَبَقَنِي بِالتَّهْجِيرِ, and I realized he had preceded me in the place. He came before me, Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu ta'ala. وَوَجَدْتُهُ يُصَلِّ, and I found him praying. فَانْتَظَرْتُ, I waited for him, حَتَّى قَضَى صَلَاتَهُ, until he finished his prayer. ثُمَّ جِئْتُ مِنْ قِبَلِ وَجْهِ, I came to him from the direction of the qibla. فَسَلَّمْتُ عَلَيْهِ, and then I gave him a salam. ثُمَّ قُلْتُ, I then said to him, وَاللَّهِ, I swear by Allah, إِنِّي لَأُحِبُّكَ فِي اللَّهِ أَمَا إِنِّي لَأُحِبُّكَ لِلَّهِ, I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah, I swear by him. Mu'adh ibn Jabal said to him, Allah, meaning, by Allah, is that why you love me? And then he said to him, Allah, by Allah, I love you. Mu'adh then said to him, Allah, is it by Allah you really love me? He then said to him, Allah, it is by Allah that I love you. Mu'adh then third time said to him, Allah, is it by Allah you love me? And then he said to him, by Allah, it's by Allah that I love you. Then he said to me, he grabbed me from the collar of my garment, فَأَخَذَ بِحُبْوَةِ رِدَائِي فَجَبَذَنِي, he pulled me. وَقَالَ, he then said to me, أَبْشِرْ, glad tidings, فَإِنِّي سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ, I heard the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم say, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, the hadith الإلهي, the hadith القدسي, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَجَبَتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلْمُتَحَابِّينَ فِيَّا وَالْمُتَجَالِسِينَ فِيَّا وَالْمُتَزَاوِرِينَ فِيَّا وَالْمُتَبَاذِلِينَ فِيَّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that my love has become something that is going to befallen anyone who loves one another for my sake, anyone who has sat with each other for my sake, and anyone who has come to visit one another for my sake, and anyone who have spoken to one another for my sake. Allahu Akbar. Ikhwani, the salaf of this ummah, the righteous pious predecessors, they only traveled from mileages and distances due to that love and that mahabbah that they had for one another. Look at the companions. They were sitting one day, as Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated, أَنَّ رَجُلًا سَأَلَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. A man asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الساعة. He said, O Messenger of Allah, when is the time? When is the hour? The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to him, وَمَاذَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا. What have you prepared for the hour? It's not enough that you ask about the hour, but what have you prepared for it? And then he said to him, قَالَ مَا أَعْدَدْتُ لَهَا مِنْ كَثِيرِ صَلَاةٍ وَلَا صَوْمٍ وَلَا صَدَقَةٍ. I have not prepared for it much salah, and I haven't prepared with it much fasting, not much sadaqah. وَلَكِنِّي أُحِبُّ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولَهُ. But I love Allah and His Messenger. That's the one thing I'm sure about. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him and he said to him, المرء مع من أحب يوم القيامة. The person is with who he loves the day of judgment. Those who love rappers, those who love singers, those who love artists, go back to who you love. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sahabas, who you should love if you want to be resurrected with them. If there's somebody you know, a brother that is pious, a brother that is knowledgeable, a brother that is good, he's noble, and you see him with good character, love him for the sake of Allah, so Allah can resurrect you with him, inshallah, the day of judgment. Anas ibn Malik said, فَوَاللَّهِ I swear by Allah, مَا فَرِحْنَا بِشَيْءٍ كَفَرَحِنَا بِقَوْلِ النَّبِيِّ. Wallahi, we did not get happy. The way we got happy that day when he said to us, الْمَرْءُ مَعَ مَنْ أَحَبْ. The person is with who he loves the day of judgment. Why did he get happy? Because he knows who he loves. Anas knew who he loved. He loved the Messenger. He loved Abu Bakr. He loved Umar. And he knew if he loved them, and he was going to be resurrected with them. What a noble status. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, Wallahi law qama rajulun ya'budu Allah bayna ar-rukni wal-maqami fi baytillahi 70 sana labu'itha aw lahushira yawm al-qiyamati ma'a man ahab. If a person, he prays between the rukn and the maqam, which is between the Kaaba, he prays there, that noble place. He stands and he prays for 70 years, and he's a noble person. How much salah he prays? He has to remember that the day of judgment, he's going to be resurrected with who he loves. The salah by itself isn't sufficient. You'll be resurrected who you have in your heart and who you love. ولذلك Abdullah ibn Umar, he used to say, Wallahi لو قمت الليلة, if I stand the whole night, he said, لو قمت الليلة, or if you stand the whole night, he's talking about himself. He said, Wallahi لو قمت الليلة لا أرقد. If I pray the whole night and I don't lie down, I don't sleep. ولو صمت النهار لا أفطر. And I fast the whole day and I don't break my fast. وأنفقت مالي كله في سبيل الله. And my whole wealth, I gave it out for the sake of Allah. أموت يوم أموت. And I die the day I die. وليس في قلبي محبة. And that in my heart there is no love. لأهل طاعة الله. I don't have no love in my heart towards the people who are obedient to Allah. I don't have that. وَبُغْضُ لِأَهْلِ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ. And I don't have in my heart hate to the people who are committing sins openly and the wrongdoers and the criminals. مَا نَفَعَنِي ذَلِكَ كُلَّهِ. My fasting, my praying, my sadaqah that I gave will not benefit me the day of judgment. The second, inshallah, which is أَلَّا يَحْمِلَ الْأَخَ لِأَخِيهِ فِي قَلْبِهِ حِقْدًا وَلَا غِلًّا وَلَا حَسَدًا. That the Muslim does not keep in his heart, which is the second right, that he does not keep in his heart towards his Muslim brother or sister any form of hate or any form of hate towards his brother. And this is a matter that we see. This characteristics of hating your brother and your sister, brothers, and having in your heart, this is a sifat min sifatil yahud. This is a characteristics from the characteristics of the Jews. This is not the characteristics of a Muslim. قال الله تعالى, Allah said, ود كثير من أهل الكتاب. They hope so much, the people of the book. لو يردونكم من بعد إيمانكم. If they can take you back after you have tasted the sweetness of iman, if they can pull you back, كفار and حسدا, they can make you كفار. حسدا من عند أنفسهم. Hate and enmity and envious and jealousy that they have in their hearts towards you. من بعد ما تبين لهم الحق. After the haqq became clear to them. So then hating and having something towards your heart in your Muslim, this is not a characteristic that a Muslim has. قال الله تعالى, Allah said, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ إِخْوَانًا عَلَى صُدُورٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ. The hearts of the believers, that enmity and that hate should be taken out. In your heart you find love. When you see your Muslim brother, it brings joy and happiness to you. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما رواه الإمامان البخاري ومسلم. The hadith Bukhari and Muslim both narrated in the authentic hadith. من حديث أنس بن مالك, the Messenger said, لا تباغضوا ولا تحاسدوا. Do not hate one another. Do not have envy and jealousy and enmity towards one another. ولا تدابروا. And don't turn your backs towards one another. وكونوا عباد الله إخوانا. Be brothers in the sake of this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be brothers in this religion. Love one another. The third rights that the Muslim has on another Muslim, which is أَنْ يَتَوَرَّ عَنْهُ بِلِسَانِ, that your tongue, you fear Allah in what you say about your Muslim brothers. Don't speak about your brothers and gossip and backbite. That's a right every Muslim has over you. قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, Allah said, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. There is not an individual, except if everything he utters that comes out of his mouth, the angels are going to be written it. And ولذلك, a poet once said, احفظ لسانك أيها الإنسان لا يلدغنك إنه ثعبان كم في المقابر من قتيل لسانه كان تهاب لقاءه شجعان. The person should fear what they say and what comes out of their mouth. For verily, how many people have spoken without watching what comes out of their mouth, and by what they have said and what has come out of their mouth, what has happened? They have fallen into what worse? They were killed because of something they said. A lot of the sins that are done, it occurs from a speech or something that was said. ولذلك, the Messenger said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the hadith Bukhari and Muslim in hadith Abi Huraira, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ, the servant, لَا يَتَكَلَّمُ, he will speak, بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّن رِضْوَانِ اللَّهِ, a speech that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا يُلْقِي لَهَا بَالًا, but not much consideration is put to it. يَرْفَعُهُ اللَّهُ بِهَا دَرَجَاتٍ, Allah will lift him because of that speech, high levels, the day of judgment. وَإِنَّ الْعَبْدَ, and a person, لا يتكلم بالكلمة من سخط الله, a person will utter some words that comes out of his mouth, but he doesn't look at what he's saying. It's so light in his eyes, but he utters those words. What happens to him? يهوي في نار جهنم. This, because of that one little word that you said, إخواني, that person will be going deep and deep and deep into the hellfire. إخواني, one of the highest things that a person should be even more scared about talking against is the scholars and the people of knowledge. Fear who what you say about those who have status. Because again, the rights of the Muslims on one another is already high. But then the scholars and the ulama and the people of knowledge are even more higher. ولذلك Ibn Asakir rahimahullah in his kitab Tariq al-Dimishq, he said, إعلم يا أخي, know my brother in Islam, في الله, وفقني الله وإياك لمرضاتي. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make ease for you, his pleasement and that which he's happy with. وَجَعَلِنِ اللَّهُ وَإِيَّاكَ مِمَّنْ يَخْشَاهُ وَيَتَّقِي حَقَّ التُّقَاتِ. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who fear him the way he deserves to be feared. اِعْلَمْ, know, بِأَنَّ لُحُومَ الْعُلَمَاءِ مَسْمُومَ, know that the flesh of the scholars is poisonous. وَأَنَّ عَادَةُ اللَّهِ فِي هَتْكِ أَسْتَارِ مُنْتَقِصِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ مَعْلُومَ. And know that anyone who wants to put down the status and the rank of the scholars and putting him is known, meaning what the outcomes that comes to that person. وَأَنَّ مَنْ أَطْلَقَ لِسَانَهُ فِي الْعُلَمَاءِ بِالثَّلْبِ بلاه الله قبل موتي بموت القلب. And anyone who opens his mouth to speak about the people of knowledge and those who are in position, meaning with ilm, of course, then remember that Allah will test you with in your heart before real death comes to you. Meaning you'll die, your iman will die, and your aqidah and what you believe. And a lot of people, للأسف الشديد, we have seen them apostate because of that which they used to say about the scholars. We've seen Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated, both of them, that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, the man asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَيُّ الْإِسْلَامِ أَفْضَلُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, which of the Islam is the best? What's the highest ranks of Islam? And the Messenger said to the man, مَنْ سَلِمَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ مِنْ لِسَانِهِ وَيَدِهِ, the person that the people find from his tongue and from his hands, peace. He's a very peaceful person. He doesn't say wrong things to the Muslims. Never will it ever come to you something he said about you. Never will he ever physically harm you. He's an individual. Words of his will never reach you. Very mashallah, great person. And that's how the Muslim should be. إخواني, من قال في مؤمن, anyone who says about a Muslim, ما ليس فيه, that which is not in that Muslim, أسكنه الله ردغة الخبال حتى يخرج مما قال وليس بخارج. And you know what ردغة الخبال means? Is عصارة أهل النار. Anyone who says about a Muslim that which he isn't, remember that person who spoke that which wasn't right about that Muslim, the day of judgment he will be put in the place of hellfire and he will be living inside the waste of the people of hellfire. So the Muslim needs to watch it. The fourth, which inshallah I'm going to conclude with, is مِنْ حَقِّ الْأَخِي عَلَىٰ أَخِي أَنْ يُحْسِنَ الظَّنَّ بِهِ, that the person thinks good of his brother. This is one of the rights that a Muslim has over you, that you think good of him. قال الله تعالى, Allah said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. In this ayah, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those of you who believe, اجْتَنِبُوا, stay away, كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ, stay away from a lot of assumptions and doubts. إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ, for verily some of the assumptions are sins. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا, and do not spy on one another. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? Do not have any form of evil assumptions of your Muslims. ولذلك, the Prophet strengthened that meaning, and he said it in the hadith that Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنِّ فَإِنَّ الظَّنَّ أَكْثَبُ الْحَدِيثِ. Abstain from assumptions, For verily, assumptions is the biggest lie in terms of talking. So by assuming that a person said something, oh, I think he said this, I think this is what he was trying to say, all of that is something that a Muslim has rights on you that you don't do. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد آخر الأنبياء في الدنيا عصرا وأجلهم يوم القيامة شأنا وذكرا صلى الله وملائكته وصالحون من خلقه كما وحد الله وعرف به ودعا إليه أما بعد. The fifth rights that the Muslim brother has on you, which is that you give him advice. You give him advice, and one has to distinguish between advising a person and shaming a person. There's a thin line between the two. Many people mix the one with the other. You need to know what advice means. وَلِذَلِكَ أَنصَحُ لِكُلِّ مَنْ يَسْتَطِيعُ أَنْ يَقْرَى. Because of that, I advise every individual over here who can read the Arabic language to go back to the hadith of Abu Ruqayyah, Tamim ibn Awsin al-Dari, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الدين النصيحة قلنا لمن قال لله ولكتابه ولرسوله ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم. الإمام حافظ ابن رجب الحنبلي, when he does the sharh of it in his kitab جامع العلوم والحكم, he explains the difference between giving advice to a person and basically shaming it. And rather, he took it to another level. Rahimahullah, he authored a whole book where he called it Al-Farq Bayna Nasihati Wa Ta'ir. The difference between advising an individual and shaming an individual. So the person needs to know that a Muslim has rights on you that you advise him. When a Muslim brother comes to you and he advises you, you need to take his advice. But the Muslim who's giving you advice, one main thing that you have to keep in mind, that the way you are dealing with this person has to be very soft and lean. Remember, you are not better than Nabiullah Musa, and Musa was ordered to be lean. And you're not the person that you're talking to is not worse than Fir'aun. So Allah told Musa alayhi salam, when he went to Fir'aun to speak to him, فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرَ أَوْ يَخْشَى. When you go to him, speak to him very kindly. Make sure you watch the words that you use the most delicate, the most softest of words. Why? So he may come back, and he comes back to his senses. But Allah knew that Muhammad Fir'aun wouldn't come, because Allah knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that which is going to happen. Allah knows. And Fir'aun, Allah knew he won't come back. So why did Allah tell him to speak? It's for the ones to come later to learn that lesson and take it. وَلِذَلِكَ Allah also ordered our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ فَعَفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَوَكِّلِينَ. Allah says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. If it wasn't from the mercy of Allah that you are lean to the companions. So look at this. If the Prophet wasn't lean to the companions, even the companions would not want to be in his surroundings. The companions would not want to be with the Prophet if he was what? فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ. If he was hard and rough and tough, the companions wouldn't even want to be around him. And this is the best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what makes you think the people want to be with you if you speak like this, if you act like this, if you talk like this, if you carry yourself like this? So when you advise wanting to bring this person back to what they have done wrong and trying to advise them.